still watching Waze. January 18th is Thesaurus Day. Impress your family and friends with big, complicated, and fancy-sounding words to celebrate the lexicographic holiday. The way to celebrate this day is to bring out your thesaurus and carry it with you the whole day, using it every time you want to speak with someone. Oh yeah, Biko, bring out your thesaurus.
But don't you feel like Nigerians actually do this every single day?
Please tell me which
one. We like big English.
Are you Patrick Ogbaya?
Exactly.
Crinkling come coming down the road.
I just find that we complicate our choice of words. You could say things so easily, but I find that we always like to, you know, I don't know if it's to sound more educated than we are, but sometimes I'm like, what are you trying to say? Can we get to the point of this story?
Sometimes
quickly?
When we use big words, we actually use it to bamboozle
Exactly. Those
who are actually listening. So some of them might not even understand what we're trying to say, but the bottom line is that they just keep nodding their head.
And that tells me that, you know, that person is not a good communicator.
Absolutely. Exactly.
Because if you're a good communicator, the person you're actually talking to should
be able understand you.
What you are saying.
Exactly.
As easily as possible, without a thesaurus.
All right, so here's what caught our attention in the news today. So, Issy, you're going first?
Okay, absolutely. In today's news, what I found in the Punch, actually, is about a motorcyclist who was knocked down by a commercial driver, and, this is the key word, and a LASMA official.
Whoa.
The LASMA official got into the vehicle and was struggling the wheel with the commercial driver, and in the process knocked down the motorcyclist, yes. And that led to something else, actually.
Wow.
Yes.
Is he dead?
No, he's not
hospitalized.
Dead. He's hospitalized.
Wow. Mm. Well, I thought the Lagos State government has actually banned Okada riders from jumping into vehicles.
LASMA officials.
I mean, LASMA officials, yeah.
I
was just going to say that banning it is one thing. What actually happens in reality is also a very different thing.
No, because I know at some point they actually got civil, because my in-law's uncle used to be the head of LASMA.
It's true.
You understand? And he said it that, you know, they had given them those strict rules. So what you do, bring out your phone, take pictures, you know, do not jump into
ensued is the fact that this happened in the hub of Lagos, and you know they are mostly unruly when it's around the Lagos Island access
area, yeah.
So that's what actually must have happened.
Well, that's what we see in Nigeria.
it's sad, the realities of the kinds of things that we go through, it just shouldn't be. Exactly, it's absolutely needless.
Yeah. Uti.
And this should have been avoided.
Yeah.
Totally. Yes.
All right, so what did you find for us in the news?
So my story was quite interesting. It was an article from Newsweek. It's a very long article, and I hope that people can go and search for it and read it. I like to look for stories. I have this funny saying that where two or more Nigerians are gathered, Nigeria will be the topic. Mm. So I find that sometimes when you listen to the news about Nigeria, or you listen to the stories out there about Nigeria, you start to lose hope. You start to think, when is Nigeria going to reach her full potential? So when I saw this story, and the headline is very catchy, you know, Black China, my first thought was, what are we Nigerians doing in China again? Whatever happened? But then it says, Africa's first superpower is coming sooner than you think. And this article lists a laundry list of things in terms of where Nigeria is right now, the current state. We know insecurity, we know all the economy issues, but it likens us to China in that in 1978, the kind of statistics that Nigeria is putting out there in terms of our level of poverty, our level of education, this is where China was in 1978. And then it talks about India, where India has a lot of similar challenges Nigeria has. So a lot of different ethnicities, culture, languages, religions. So in that sense, we are where India was in 1991. And what are the things these countries did to become, to get to where they are now? So they were able to deregulate. They were able to allow competition, allow investment, foreign investment to come in, bureaucracy. There was a very interesting line in the article that says, you hope that the government ignores your business when you're successful. You just want to be under the radar. Because the minute the government notices you, there's one tax person. If you're in Lagos State, someone is always trooping into your office to come and collect one money or the other one, you know. So it talks about really those different elements of things that will allow us become the superpower. It doesn't say that we will,
but it sort of talks about all the different...
It said about the potential, because I
read... Exactly, it's the potential.
What scared me in this article, because I read the article, what scared me was the fact that they said in 20... is it
in
30 years? In
30 years, we will be larger than the US by population.
By population,
and at the end of the decade, we'll be
Nigeria.
Yes. And by the end of the decade, Nigeria will be the third most populated country in the world.
So, here I was just thinking, Biko, where will we put all these people?
Thank you.
Because is the government actually ready, and are they making plans for infrastructure that would accommodate
this
kind of scary analogy that came out?
Uh-huh.
I was really scared when I read that part.
Probably the same thing that happened in China years ago might have to play out.
Of course,
in
people,
Africa,
they'll start telling
Nigeria.
You have one baby and all of that.
That we become the third largest country by population, but we will actually be the most densely populated country on the planet.
Can you imagine?
I'm really happy we're talking tourism, because I want to see how this population will play out in terms of, you know. Because it can actually swing to our favor if we know how to harness it.
Aww. This one tells us that one of our resources is people. It even mentions that our largest export now is not oil, it's actually people.
Yes, human resource.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, so my story is quite interesting because I took the story yesterday about the building collapse that happened. And luckily, somebody was saved.
In the rubble.
I think he stayed there for about 7 hours, if I can recall. Yeah, and he was under the rubble. Yeah, and he's alive, and I'm happy. You know, I just thought to mention this because every time we see things like this, the first scare that comes is
somebody
has died, and all of that. I'm happy they were able to rescue the young man.
Oh, that's a good one.
Happening though. Time after time,
I am seriously tired. And I'm happy, I will still mention it again. Next week, we're talking about architecture. All of that. So we'd need to start putting in certain measures. Even you, when you contract someone that is supposed to be a professional, you should have some checks to see if that person is actually
quality
meeting,
control.
Yes, that is meeting. So even if the government will not do their job, you as an individual.
You should have
your checklist to be sure that you have been knowledgeable to see that they're using the right materials.
Or you contract it to someone who is knowledgeable if you're a total novice.
There must be some checks.
Checks, yeah.
Exactly.
That's there should
important.
Be some checks.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
All right, so as we said earlier, today we're talking tourism in Nigeria, and Sam Adeleke joins us after the break. Please stay with us.